Hold on to your seats. The fun and excitement of duckpin bowling is rolling your way. It's time for Duckpin Magic.
Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Duckpin Magic. Got Mike Sella with me, Joe Ryanair, in week number two of our WNDA tournament. We're down to 10 bowlers now, Joe, and the excitement level continues to rise.
Well, two things haven't changed, Mike. First place is still $2,000, and the top seed is still Diane Jasper. We have 9 games left to get there.
All right, our first match will come up for you right after this, so don't go away.
First match today features Teresa Pearson and Corinne Jones.
Once again, the higher bowler chooses to go first. Corinne Jones, no stranger to TV, has not yet won a Pro Tour or a major tournament, has a high single of 233, and that's strong, Mike. That's a big game. She's finished third on the Pro Tour one time. That's her highest finish.
Yep, starts off with a nice spare. Teresa Pearson, who came on in the last frame to defeat Carol Giddings in last week's last show, to move on to this week and continue in the hunt for that star and $2,000 first prize on this Grand Prix WNDA event. We'll step in now. Well, the winner last week averaged about 146, 147. To win the three shows, and we'll see what happens this week. But both bowlers out of the box quickly with marks.
I tell you, some bowlers sitting higher on the ladder, meaning first, second, third, should be happy that Teresa Pearson is down here where she is, because I tell you, she really looks comfortable, Mike. I really like the ease, and she just looks like she's really trusting that stroke. Now, there's a little bit of tough luck. She just pushed it through the middle, but there's no hitch whatsoever. The arm's just nice and fluid. Tough three count and 13 in the first frame. Corinne Jones, of course, also marked in frame number one.
Teresa has two boys, Tommy and Travis. Home watching, no doubt.
12 and 5 years old. Big opportunity for Corinne early in the match as Teresa punched the middle out on her mark. Corinne, of course, bowling frame 2 with the mark in the first frame.
Yep.
All's fair in love and war, huh? 13. Tell you, Corinne's strong for, as far as...
Oh, look at that!
Nice shot.
Two real tough spares, and she converts both.
Very aggressive for a little gal. Sort of built, I'd say, on the slender side. Uses the whole approach, if you look.
Yeah, she's got the back heel hanging off the end of the approach. Yeah, she'll take that. 9 drop on the mark, 32 after 2. Missed it. Try to pick it up here with the third ball. Mary Garner waiting in the wings for the winner of this match.
Same lady that just made two tough ones in the... Just wasn't enough challenge there in this single, I guess, Mike.
And she comes back, picks it up with the third one, and now Teresa Pearson will step in, third frame. And a strike. Well, she's got that big pocket like you talk about, Joe. She can hit them down from either side of the head pin.
Right.
Teresa will bowl frame number four. Hutch comes up with a strike and a spare in the third and fourth frames, does Teresa Pearson. Into three complete frames, tied up at 42, although Teresa has her mark in the fourth. And here's Corinne Jones.
All right, the 3-10. See if she gets down and through the ball. A little short.
No, she
got away with it. Caught it on the outside, Mike, and kicked the 10 off the wall. You could see a little help right at the end.
So both bowlers put up spares in the fourth frame.
Okay, got away with that. A little bit of pull. Counted seven, left the 1-3-9, very makeable spare. Watch at the end, Mike, just see if she comes through. She did. You know, you could see she didn't have the little pull to the left that time. She sort of, I just call it trust in your stroke, and snapped it right in the 1-3 pocket for the spare.
See what Teresa does here with her mark in the fourth. And the five gets
I tell you,
out.
Mike, that's her stroke is almost pure. I mean, it's so effortless, and it's straight. There's no guiding, no helping the ball whatsoever.
Well, out of five frames, she's got four marks, including two strikes and three in a row here in third, fourth, and fifth frames.
She's been near perfect with every ball. She had just happened to throw the first ball in the second frame through the middle. Two, five, seven, still counting on the strike. Let's see if she bangs away on that front pin.
Yep, she did. And
little tough luck there, just didn't throw the two far enough to the left, sort of went behind the number seven.
Ten frame, 91 after six. And Corinne Jones steps in. Husband Brian Jones Sr. watching.
It's getting a little quick, Mike. I tell you, when a smaller person uses the whole approach, one of the tendencies is to rush. She uses that whole approach in four steps. So if you watch her, you tend to take long strides, which make you run. You see the last three steps, they're pretty quick. Caught the head pin on the outside, and it just jumped around to number six. A bit of tough luck there. We still have a close game. If she hits this, give her 86.
Yep.
She didn't. 85.
So
Teresa.
It's a six-pin advantage for Teresa Pearson, and both bowlers will be open in the sixth frame.
Four marks apiece. Four spares for Corinne. Two and two for Teresa. Two spares, two strikes.
Spin off the head pin to the left. This frame and the last frame.
Difficult thing to adjust, Mike. If you get fast with your feet, with her style, you really have to stay aggressive. And she's getting fast with her feet, but she's also getting cautious with her hand.
No,
she kicked it that time. Looked like she snuck by another one there.
Yep. Spare. She's scrambling to pick up those spares. Nothing easy. Now here's Teresa Pearson bowling in the seventh. Holding a slim lead here. Get up, get up, get up.
tell you, Mike, if she maintains the rhythm and tempo that she has right now and keeps trusting that swing, I mean, she has to get by this game. But I'm telling you, they got a pretty tough opponent on their hands. When you see somebody get that comfortable, it's...
Well, it's her third strike in the match. Strikes in the third, fifth, and seventh frames. Spares in the first and the fourth.
You want to beat her, you have to keep her off the right-hand lane. Three out of four, she's four out of four. The first frame was a spare, and three strikes after that. Tough break, four, seven, and 10. Caught the head pin a little full, but when you're on a count, you'd much rather have a split than chop the middle or chop the side. So still counting, I'd say she's gonna shoot the 4-7, pretty careful. Try to get both of them.
Give it a good try.
She's hit a lot of object pins, Mike, with each ball, first, second, and third ball. She's thrown pretty much where she wants it most of the time.
And she's got the 10, so 120 after eight frames. Corinne Jones working on a mark in the seventh.
She's going to need a mark.
95 plus.
Let's watch the footwork. One, two, three, four.
And a strike right back.
We watch the lead switch hands here as Corinne's just sort of a relentless pursuit. Had two open frames. Big frame, ninth frame, working on a strike for Corinne.
And a double.
Wow, done with much authority. She had three frames in a row where she pulled the ball left, made two of the spares though, Mike, which were a big factor, and was really robbed out of the other one as she left the number six.
Now here's Teresa Pearson now to bowl the ninth and 10th.
Oh,
very close to being a strike as she sent three or four pins in search of the last one standing.
Solid proof you don't have to throw the ball at a high speed to move pins around.
Yep. Let that one get away.
I'd say the double caused that. And the desire to want that strike so bad when she was sort of robbed out of the strike, it deflates you a little bit and you tend not to get your concentration back to shoot it. Well, I tell you, she's got her work cut out right here. If she spare, strike, she can shoot 150. Corinne, 125 plus in the eighth, and it's pretty much Corinne's game here if Teresa doesn't make something happen. I tell you, the spare in the ninth's going to prove to be a lot bigger mark than Teresa thought, I believe. The double, once again, a big offense and a big defense all in one ball. This is certainly a must that she make this, a 139.
No.
Wow, when the worm turns, he certainly heads the other way, doesn't he? Tough game to lose. Five marks, probably gonna shoot 140 if she hits this pin.
She's got it.
Real nice job. It's gonna come up short.
Here's Corinne Jones now working on the double.
Just want to stay away from anything drastic happening. Stay behind the line, keep the ball out in front of you, which she did very well, and she will be Mary Garner's opponent. We have in this show, on the last match of this show, will be Betty Byram, Rookie of the Year, Mike.
Corinne Jones puts up another mark just for insurance, and we'll finish out with a terrific game. Got a possibility of 170 here. And she does.
171, Mike. Real nice
beautiful
game.
Yep, beautiful game from Corinne Jones. Wins at 171, 140, and she goes on to face Mary Garner when we come back right after this. Mary Garner and Corinne Jones, our second match. This is Mary Garner. First time we've seen her. She's got a high league average, 136, high single, 209, high three-game set of 515. She'll take on Corinne Jones, who just tossed a 171 out there just to show people. Well, Mary was looking at a tough spare attempt, but we had that spinning pin on the deck, which took care of all but one. And she takes advantage of it.
Kind of hard for me to believe that she has not won a pro tour. She's a tough competitor. Comes Corinne.
Well, the women aren't wasting any time. They're shooting real bullets in the first frame. No, nothing to get yourself warmed up for the match.
Hey, if you want to keep up, you better come out of the gate.
Yeah, that's a good one. Right, we saw Corinne last game make three spares, which were unlikely. And that helped her beat Teresa Pearson. Of course, the double in the eighth and ninth didn't hurt.
Yeah, well, you know, she sort of hung around, stayed out of trouble, even though she pulled a few balls left, recovered with the second ball. And then when she did get the first ball where she wanted it, it was very active. You know, it's a live ball. She got her rhythm where she wanted it and just stayed aggressive. Here again, we see a spare in the first frame and turned to, you know, a tough spare she made, turns around and pushes one through the middle, similar to the last game. I tell you, she's moving pins around, Mike, which only tells me that she's turning that ball very well. And she throws a tight ball, but even the color in the, you can watch. I mean, the ball really, it's turning so quick, yep. You can hardly see it.
So a 10 frame for Corinne Jones, 25 after two, and Mary Garner will step in. She has two children. Yep. Now she got a break again.
Well, actually turned out a whole lot better than did Corinne with her pushing hers through the middle. Mary got way off to the left, looked for a minute like she was going to get one, ended up with a spare break and a seven count. One, two, three, the same object she shot with the first ball.
And this time she gets it.
I tell you, Mike, that's a big psychological frame for both bowlers. You have Mary, who actually got away with murder, and she knows it, and bounced right back and made the spare, and Corinne sitting watching her get away with murder, thinking, boy, I'm in good shape. She just pulled that off and, you know, is going to have a bad break, and it just didn't happen that way.
And a strike.
What a big ball the first ball was last frame, Mike, to get away with it. I mean, you don't know what the outcome would have been
around.
Had she plunked one, right? It would could have changed everything. Corinne's got to bounce back again, and we know she knows how to do that. We watched it happen in her first victory.
Five pin remains. Well, Mary Garner taking her shot. Goes spare, spare, strike in the first three frames.
The winner of this game will go on to face Betty Byram, Rookie of the Year.
Corinne posts her second of three, or second mark in three frames. Well, you don't get off to a fast start against these ladies, you're going to be trailing way behind.
Better get here early, right? They'll start without you. Big ball here.
Ooh, tough one.
Let it spin. Trying to get closer, but got to shoot one and one. I mean, I think mentally, this part of the game, you have to learn to accept that those breaks are going to happen, and you have to just shoot one and one and not let it affect the ball the next frame.
Ooh. She had
shoot
touched
one
that,
and
she
one
had
my
had
foot.
Yeah, she came real close there.
She didn't want 10. She traded a nine for a possible spare, is what she traded in here. She gave up a pin to try to make the shot. Not a bad gamble this early in the game, Mike.
52 after four, and here's Mary Garner stepping in.
An opportunity.
Two spares and a strike to start the match.
She could open a 20-plus pin lead here with the mark in the fourth frame.
Yep.
She's working on a strike, so she'll want to hit one. Yeah. So many times when you're on a strike, you, let me tell you, over the course of time, Mike, 1-1, if you're on a strike, you're going to make out a whole lot better because it, you know, it does count double. Unless you're in a must situation, you certainly can't make it unless you hit one of them anyway. So it's, I think you really don't have a game plan for that. It just happens at the time it takes place. Your mind says, well, go for it. It's how you feel at the time.
66 after four for Mary Garner, so she's got a 14-pin lead.
Waiting for her first ball to come back. Another break off the side, 1-3-6. Knocked the number one off, shooting a 3-6 for a 10.
That she got the other two, puts up a 10 on the board, but two back-to-back open frames for the first time in the match for Mary Garner, and in steps Corinne Jones.
Yeah. Up jump the middle when you're trying to catch up. That's not what you need.
Oh.
Hey, Mike, she has some pins moving on the deck. I tell you, it's snapping that thing real well. See, there's always something. Even that came back.
Yeah. Still a 14-pin advantage for Mary Garner. Rookie of the Year Betty Byram standing by to bowl next, with the winner of our next match moving on to next week's show, facing three new challengers or competitors.
Made a mistake, I believe, F frame. She had the 1-3-6 and the 4 and sort of favored the pocket again. You saw what happened. She caught the back one. 9 frames, 71, 76 for Mary Garner. Of course, Mary's through 5 frames, Corinne through 6, so 15-pin lead.
Spot in the match where Mary Garner could increase her lead and stretch it out just a bit. Oh. Watch out.
Once again, got away with the stray ball, pulled way left. And
well, Mary, I'll tell you, you're on the head pin, only bad things can happen.
Well, she just watched Corinne chop the middle, and the same thing happened the last time, you know, so maybe she is learning.
Oh, just did get it.
And there's only one, that's all you have to do, touch it.
She's sort of shaking her head, though, even though she got the mark, she.
One of those cases.
Very happy with where the ball's going.
You know, you just threw two bad balls and made a spare. And sooner or later, that does catch up to you. And Mary knows it. You keep going left like she's doing, and you're going to chop two, or worse than that, chop one. You know, you've got to put the ball up on the head pin in this caliber of bowling.
Well, she did there and took advantage of it. Puts up her second strike.
That was a big ball.
96 after 6, so she has taken a 25-pin lead.
And has her
the
strike.
Mark.
Yep. Nice shot. That's a tough shot.
Yeah, it really is.
Corinne, ball for ball, you know, has bowled a good game. She just had a couple things not go her way, and before you know it, you're in the sixth, seventh frame, and when you have somebody making five out of seven marks and a couple 10 counts, you can get behind in a hurry. Corinne has to make something happen right here. You never know. We've watched a double over the last couple weeks be a, you know, a winning weapon.
Well, 171 for Corinne in the last game was her high for today. Previous high was 170 in the head-to-head semifinals. And there's a strike.
Pretty ball.
Well,
well done.
She keeps herself in the game with that.
Well, it keeps you in it anyway. It's sets you up. You know, she still has a shot to throw four more, Mike. That said, we give her 171 again.
Now, here's Mary Garner with the mark here. Can... She'll count seven plus this ball.
Mary, another bowler that just sort of stays in that nice, easy rhythm. Never really, well, you saw what happened. When she forces the ball, it goes left. And she has to just keep her tempo at a nice, even pace, sort of slow. You could see her hand go around that ball. Just got a little quick with her feet. Ball got behind her and never caught up.
Now she'll count 10, 124 after 8.
Yeah, she definitely has, with a couple of 10 frames, has Corinne on a double somewhere between here and the end of the game. If she were to make a mark in the ninth or 10th, she could almost close her out or at least put her on a triple.
Yep, off the left side again.
That was bound to happen. Sooner or later, you're going to... Nice try, but I really don't like what I'm seeing. She has a nice lead, but if you watch, the stroke's not there. The hand's really going around the ball, Mike. And
so let's see. Ninth frame, she finishes up with a 132, and here's Corinne Jones. Chance to get back in the match with a couple of marks.
I tell you, now she can go spare, strike, spare, and force Mary to get 10. Oh, my. There we go. Instant replay. That's what Mary had. Three off the left side. Working on a strike, Mike, so we can still work this out. Pulled that first ball left. She has to come on through and stay aggressive. Right like that.
Wow.
Now she's in big trouble. She hits both of these and triples. Mary would need 8 to win. So.
Well, 107 after 9.
The first ball's not a strike. Mary Garner will be going on to face Betty Byram in her final match this week.
Yep, right through the middle once again.
Next week, Mike, we have Pat Malton, Debbie Conrad, and Carol Cook.
Corinne will have one more ball here in the 10th frame. Finishes up with a 116. And Mary Garner will step in. Mary be looking to get a good stroke going here for the next match.
This wants to sharpen things up a little. That was a little better. Keep it there. You'll fare better than the 7-8 in most cases. Final week of the Grand Prix. We have Tracy Quayle, third seed, Sue Hannon, second, and Diane Jasper sitting on top.
As we get a little closer to that week, we'll tell you a little bit about the Bowler of the Year race that's going on. But that is it. Mary Garner has won it, 142-116. And we'll be back to watch her take on Betty Byram right after this. Okay. Mary Garner takes on Betty Byram. And Betty, of course, winner of a Pro Tour event in her very first year on the WNDA, and she has already been declared the Rookie of the Year.
Good ball by Mary. Yep.
Betty won her tournament at Hagerstown. In fact, I think she climbed the ladder from the fifth seed or even the wild card spot to,
really?
To do it. Mary Garner, again, starts out quickly. The women have not wasted any time in each of the matches this week and last week. They've all started out very quickly. And if you fall behind early, it's very tough to try to catch up.
Watched her bowl earlier, Mike, and that was not what I saw her doing earlier. She's a little stage fright, even though she has won one. It was not a TV stop.
Right.
And a little hitch in the stroke at time. If you watch the arm swing, and just watch for the smoothness and the release, and you can pretty much tell whether a bowler's on their game.
And she's got it. Well, that may settle some of the nerves.
It'll certainly help.
Ball went right where she wanted it to go. Betty's married, has a daughter, age 10, and she works at the University of Maryland, just right up the street.
Right around the corner. Computer programmer, analyst. That should tell you how to see if she's got the right program in for her game. And again, you know, Mike, and I didn't want to point it out at the time, but even when she made the slide shot for the spare, the hand didn't really come through the ball well. It's getting on the side of the ball, and from what I watched in the qualifying, that's not her stroke. See that hand? I mean, it's really flying out on the side of the ball, and that was not happening. I watched her shoot 342, 181, and 161 the first two games of the qualifying today.
Right.
And at that
fell
point,
off quite a bit the last three games, so maybe that's where the game started to get off track a little bit. Mary Garner will step back in. Mary has sort of used up, she's a cat, used up a few of the lives that they have there. She's come away with some out of the pocket hits. Well, that one wasn't one of them.
She's adjusted, and if you noticed, her elbow and hand the last two frames now, I'm not to say it won't happen again, but she's got it back under the ball. The last couple frames of her victory kind of drove through that ball, but we watched I call it the flying elbow earlier or today, but late in the match that she just won, and it didn't look good.
So she opens up with back-to-back marks. Takes a three-pin plus lead here in the second frame. Third of three matches today on Duckpin Magic.
Nice try.
Yep,
5-10. She'll be shooting one. Give her 43 in the third. Got it. Well, Betty, try to get something going here. Let's see if she get this thing straightened out here and smooth it out a little bit. She's just really hitting it hard right at the end, and it's not a straightforward type flip. She's gonna get tennis elbow if she keeps it up. Much better.
Yep.
I mean, that is her motion to go there, but not that quick jerk that we were seeing earlier. That was a nice smooth ball, and I think she sort of compensated for what she was doing by probably telling herself, get the ball out on the lane a little bit, you know. That will stop you from going around the side of the ball. Got to trust her stroke on this. The number 10 pin for a spare.
Yeah. Got enough of it to count. She's got her second mark of the match.
It's about as much reaction as you're going to see out of Betty is the little jump right there. She thought she may go by the number 10. Just stay there a little longer. She's got to be very high in confidence, Mike, to have joined the tour, won a tour, be the rookie of the year. It's going to be a plus for her at this point. Of course, it still has quite a few rungs left in that ladder. Pretty ball. That hand was even more under it that time.
Well, there are eight bowlers left. The winner here will advance to next week's program. Let's see, against three more bowlers.
She's going to win seven games in a row to win the tournament from this point.
Something we've never seen anybody do. We've seen them win five games, but certainly not.
We don't know they wouldn't have won more. They won it, and it made them stop, right? They were sort of limited.
Well, several months back, we saw Al Bissonnette win a special tournament from the seventh seed. It was back in Connecticut at the Barnum Lanes. He's going to look to pick up one here. Give herself 52. But Betty has taken the lead with her two marks in the third and fourth.
I tell you, all the matches, we've watched the lead change hands, Mike.
It's been back and forth, up and down. Certainly been exciting matches.
Even the one we thought was over ended up 146-145.
Yeah, there she is.
Crowd's into this one, Mike.
Yeah. Shaping up as an exciting match as we're nearly halfway through.
Well, the reason for the excitement in the crowd is you have Betty Byram, who is right from the Riverdale area here and bowls here at PG, and then you have from the Baltimore area, sort of an old rivalry type thing in Mary Garner. That rivalry is more in the bleachers than it is in the seats. So. Clean up some wood, hit the number one pin here as the lead's gonna change hands once again, Mike, in the fifth frame. Betty with a seven pin lead, 59-52 through four. Betty goes on to get 67 in the fifth. Mary Garner with the strike, 62 plus. Very interesting.
Yep, back and forth. Of course, the winner of this match has the unenviable task next week of facing off head-to-head with Pat Malthan.
Many stars on her back from victims that have fallen to her. Betty just cannot get in stroke and stay there. It's a little bit of a battle for her right now. For the people in the back.
Now it's up to Mary Garner.
It's amazing. The crowd gets into it. The bowlers get into it. We can get into it. Two pin spare break, two and four. Tight situation.
Yep, she's got it.
Five pin lead through five frames. Both bowlers with a spare in the sixth frame. 77 plus for Betty Byram. 82 plus for Mary Garner. They turn up the heat, Mike.
little too tight. Punches through the middle. Count five on the mark. 87 after six.
Ten's a big number, Mike.
Yep.
Force Betty to mark to take the lead with the 10 here.
She's got the 10.
Tough shooter.
97 after 7. Betty steps in.
Shows a lot of poise, Mike. In a tight game, in that situation, you throw the ball through the middle. You have to throw two more good balls to get 10, and it's much more difficult in many cases than making a single. You got to keep your concentration and just hang in there. Convince yourself you're still in the game and make 10 out of it. Betty on a mark in frame six.
There's a strike.
She really fought it, but she kept her hand under the ball that time, Mike. And I tell you, she has a live ball when she stays under it.
Well, it's all tied up, although Betty Byram will be counting on a strike in the seventh to help her take the lead here.
Waiting for that ball to come back. Here it comes. Takes it a little longer to get back than it does for her to get it down there.
She doesn't waste any time. Once she's poised and ready to deliver, she takes off. She steps up on the approach, and it's take aim and fire.
Oh, pretty ball. The hand come up through that one, Mike. I mean, that was near perfection the last two frames.
Looking to pick up the single.
She'll tie the game and have her mark in the eighth. Well, actually take a 10-pin lead. I'm sorry, give her 107 with the strike in the seventh. That helped. Force in it. This just didn't trust it and helped it a little, and it went left. So she'll have a 9-pin lead. She hits this pin. Okay.
I think she
wanted that double so bad she just lost concentration in shooting a single. And I tell you, it was hit for the pin was headed for the eight, and it just had like a reverse spin on it, came to a stop. And we have Mary Garner trying to close the gap here. She's down 9 pins in the eighth frame. To make a shot, 5-7.
She'll be looking to pick up at least one of these. A 108, 106 rather, so it's a 10-pin advantage in the eighth for Betty Byram, WNDA's Rookie of the Year.
Big shot here, Mike.
He's got it.
Okay, a 10-pin lead for Betty. But Mary has her mark in frame 9, as Betty will get up and bowl the 9th and 10th frame. Again, I think a big edge to be bowling both of these frames, you know, in succession. She can mark either one of them. She can force Mary Garner to mark. Stole one too many. Left a 2-7-8. She would have loved to have had the number one pin along with that. I'll tell you what you want to do right here is just practice your stroke. You have another frame. You have a 10-pin lead. Bang on the number two pin and just get yourself under control, ready to bowl the 10th frame. And if you make it, all well and good. Hey, nice nine, a good place for something like that to happen. She can jump up and go spare nine, spare eight. She's going to force Mary to throw a big count and another big count.
Let's see what happens here in the 10th frame. 125, 116 plus.
See, the big thing here, Mike, if Betty can go, let's say she gets 18 or 19, if Mary's first ball is seven or less, she can't win.
Well, Betty has an opportunity here to pick up the mark.
Tell you, this match has brought the sounds of a sellout crowd.
It's been a good one, too. Back and forth and still up for grabs. And she's got it.
Big spare there, Mike. Big, big spare. It takes a lot off of Betty's shoulders and throws it back over onto Mary's. Because I think Mary was sitting in the driver's seat right there until Betty made the mark. Mary was still going to need a mark. There was no doubt she was on a mark. But now she can force her to double with a big count here, or at least to strike. A 10 count, Mary would have to throw a strike to win.
See what happens here with this fill. There's an eight. 143 the final for Betty Byram.
If Mary's first call is seven, she can strike, make it and strike and tie. If it's less than seven on this ball, she can't win.
All right, let's see what happens with Mary Garner for the match. Well, she's got the nine.
Okay, what she has to do is make this and get eight more. Nine more, really, to win, eight
right.
to tie.
And in the event of a tie, of course, we have a two-frame roll-off.
I don't believe we're going to have a tie.
You don't think so? Okay.
It's going to go one way or the other.
Well, it's a mark.
Do you know that eight is probably the number least broke? Trust me.
Okay. Well, it's up to Mary Garner. Sure is. Here it is. Oh.
What a match. 143-140, Mike.
Right up to the ball, hits the head pin and pushed through. It was a terrific match in anybody's game. 143-140, free pin win for Betty Byram. She advances to next week, and we'll be back to wrap things up right after this.
Welcome back to Fairlane's Prince George. I'm Mike Sella. We have seen an exciting couple of matches this week and more to come on Duckpin Magic as the WNDA Grand Prix will continue next week. Betty Byram, winner of that exciting match, will be back, and we'll have all the action for you right here. For Joe Rainier, I'm Mike Sella. See you again next time, everybody, right here on Duckpin Magic.
Hold on to your seats. The fun and excitement of duckpin bowling is rolling your way. It's time for Duckpin Magic. Hold on to your seats. The fun and excitement of duckpin bowling is rolling your way. It's time for Duckpin Magic.
Hi, everybody, and welcome back to Duckpin Magic. I'm Mike Sella, with me Joe Rainier. We also have a couple of WNDA bowlers with us, Will DeGarette and, of course, Betty Byram. And, Will, you have a presentation to make, I guess.
Yes, at this time we'd like to present to Betty Byram the 1990 Rookie of the Year Award, plus a check for $100.
Very good. Congratulations, Betty. And I know what, we've got a match for you to bowl, so we won't hold you up too long. But, Joe, got four more bowlers this week, and we're halfway up to climb up the ladder.
Yeah, we're down to seven, Mike, and they're still looking for Miss Jasper, who's sitting on top.
Okay, we'll get our first match going for you right after this. Stay with us.
Back here at Fairlane's Prince George, Pat Malton and Betty Byram set to go at it. Bat Malthen, the all-time winningest lady pro on the WNDA Tour.
Don't turn your back or you'll miss Pat. It does not take her very long to throw one, two, or three balls.
You can see the number of wins represented by the stars in the back of her bowling shirt there, and it goes from one shoulder to the other. Man, how about that for a mark to start? Well, got the 1988 Bowler of the Year for the WNDA facing off against the 1990 Rookie of the Year in Betty Byram. So the presentation made by Wilda Garrett of the WNDA at the top of the show. Betty won her last match 143-140, an exciting match over Mary Garner. Sort of posted the 143 and then held her breath, I guess you would say, yeah?
She doesn't want the extra pin at this time. Okay. 178, still a very difficult shot. We saw Pat Malthen make a difficult shot to start the game. Tough shot. I tell you, you just do not want to give Pat Malthen a chance to get out and run because she knows how to do it.
Winner here will be facing off against Debbie Conrad, and yet to come up on this show will be Carol Cook, who is the actual number four seed. So we have seeds 4, 5, and 6 facing off number 7, Betty Byram. First 2 weeks of the climb up the ladder has been any indication. We should have some exciting matches coming up this week as well.
There you saw a very live ball, the number 5 standing with 3 pins looking for it, and none of them found it. Big spare here. Second frame, Pat already has her mark in frame 1. Betty went open with a 10 frame, so. Big ball, confidence builder right here.
You know, well, one thing Mike, you don't want to do is certainly give Pat Malthen an open door to walk through, because a lot of times she doesn't need the door to be open. She just comes through anyway.
You could almost tell when the preparation that Betty took to shoot that pin that she had some doubt. I have no idea why, but she did some unusual, not the same as she's been acting as she prepared to shoot other spares. Took a little bit longer. There you see an 8 count for Pat, 18 to 10 after one frame, and the 7 and 9, very unlikely.
After 2 frames, Pat Malthen and Betty Byram going head to head here, midway up the climb of a 13-woman ladder. There's a strike. And somebody will get the crowd fired up. Pat will certainly do the job.
I tell you what, when Pat's wrapped up in the game, she really doesn't care if the crowd gets cranked up. She gets herself cranked up, and it's good for her game. I mean, she just.
Hello?
129. This is a big ball, Mike. She needs to hit the head pin, get herself ready for frame number 4. This frame's gone, and just throw a nice. Yep, see, had a pull in that one. Take a deep breath and start all over. Miss Pat can be a little intimidating at times. When you watch her make her approach and you see the stars on her back, that in its own right has to get your attention. $2,000 first place.
Well, during the Hagerstown stop, the one in which Betty Byram won, the first person she beat on the up the ladder climb was Pat Moth. So she's faced her before head to head.
Good ball. Good ball. What was the score, do you know? Have any idea?
136-109.
I would say Pat's not going to bowl 109 today. Wow. Got it on the way by for first spare. Frame 4, 39 plus for Betty. Pat, 36 plus frame 3 with a strike working.
Hey. Double. Pat made herself smile on that one. Well, she stomps that foot after the ball's gone. I thought
tell
that
you
was
what,
enough to knock down the 10
pins. Yes, sir.
Pins.
I'd hurt for a month if I did that, Mike.
Well, she's looking for the triple. Ooh, came pretty darn close to it also.
Well, I tell you what, she did all she could do. Put it where it needed to be. I tell you, you don't want to turn your back because she's on her way to the line, I tell you. See, now there's a little bit of where you got to calm yourself down after the nine. You know, it's as experienced as this lady is, it's still, when the adrenaline's moving, Mike, it's a little hard to stay under control.
Well, what that does is give Betty a chance to get back in the match after the double by Pat Moffan in the third and fourth frame. Betty Byram working off the spare in the fourth. Big ball for her here. She throws a good one and she can get right back in the match.
Kick him out of there. All right, we get a match here. 48 and 20, what, six pins for Pat Morgan, but Betty's shooting at a mark in frame 5 and Pat was open in frame 5. I tell you, they're all big when you fall this far behind, Mike, at this point. You just got to keep chipping away at it. You're not going to pick 26 up with one ball, so you just throw one at a time. Pat's got a little buzz in the crowd, and I think it makes concentration a little bit tough for the opponent. You really have to work on that. Like you said, Pat can get them fired up. Pat averaged 150 today, shooting 750 with 110 and 118 game. But in the other three games, she had 64, 75, and 83. So
second highest pinfall behind Diane Jasper, who's the number one seed.
She just lost one game.
Yeah, those two games undoubtedly, 118 and 110, cost her in the head-to-head decision.
I would be pretty easy to say that they were probably the two losses that she had.
Can't say for sure. Here. We don't have that in front of us.
Oh, my. One of those games, of course, these two bowlers being the first game today, the winner will be going on to face Debbie Conrad and just getting a step closer to the final match. Not a try. Nice try. All right, nice 10.
67 after 6. Pat Moffan, 84 after 5, and is up in the sixth here. Nope.
Similar to the shot she started with. If you watch Pat, she looks straight down when she bowls. See where she's looking? She just puts it out to the spot.
Cat's not doing anything to run away with this match at this point.
Doing all she can to keep it close, huh? 23 pins. 90-67, both bowlers have completed six frames. Pat Maltin, frame number seven. Another toughie, 2-10.
Nice try by Pat.
I tell you, if you watch, the success of Pat's game is just, she's got a nice short backswing, keeps her shoulders square at the line, and
Pat's trying to pick up a win on the tour. She's not gone through a year where she hasn't won at least one since 1984.
And she has not won one so far this year.
Right.
This being the final, the Grand Prix. Betty taking her time, get herself set.
Yep, big frame right here.
Sure is. Pat's going open three times since the double.
Yes, she got it.
Big spot for that. Oh, attention getter, Mike. You can't throw a double until you get the first one.
Well, with a double, she can counteract Pat's double back in the third and fourth frames.
Yeah, a lot of things that'll make everything even because, you know, Betty broke nine on the spare that she made and just missed it. Of course, Pat broke eight. And Pat's had a couple bad wood frames. You know, she had eight on and eight out in the second frame. Had a six frame in the sixth frame, so big ball. Need a little luck. That's trying to walk over, I believe. We may get one more out of this. I'd be in no hurry to. Nope, they wasn't going to get it. It's got a little better angle than we do, Mike. 1-2-8 and a big, big spare. Almost a must. Eighth frame, 20 behind, 23 behind. She's got to have this spare. Boy, tell me it's not a game of inches. That's the pin that the spinner was sort of heading for.
-95 after 8.
I tell you, Pat's stars almost look like a straight line. There's how many are on there, Mike?
I think there's 8.
A minimum. Yep.
Yep. Won her first star in the first year of the WNDA, 1983. Skipped the year in 84, won 2 in 85, 1 in 86, 2 in 87, 1 in 88, and 1 last year in 89. Here we are in 90, and just does miss that. She's been in the ladder a couple of times this year, but down further in the ladder than I think she's used to, and it's tougher to make the climb.
Well, her forte is that she can shoot a big score, and she wins games, so many cases she's probably won from the top or second spot where she's winning one or two games, Mike. Not to say that she can't win a string of them, but it's not necessary. You know, she posts a big score, one of the higher average bowlers in the game, and it just gives her that little bit of an edge.
Oh, it fell over.
Where's she stand in the average this year?
Sixth, as a matter of fact, with about a 140 average.
Yeah, she's so steady. You know, she just constantly pumps out the 140, stays away from the bad game. Very seldom has a bad tour, you know, where she's not somewhere near either qualifying or qualifying. Pin lead for Pat Maltin, and she has her mark in the ninth as Betty will bowl frames 9 and 10 and definitely needs a pair of marks.
No, the first one she's got to take care of right here in the ninth.
Well, this is a must. Almost squeezed it off, a nice shot. See, if she marks here and then counts again, she can shoot in the 130s, which Pat has pretty easy. So she really has to catch a double here to put any pressure on Pat Maughlin. This first ball must be a strike, or Pat will just need a count. She has two balls to do it. A lot different game if Pat were on a spare, but she's on a strike, and that gives you room to make a little mistake. Yep, I'd say just about over, Mike, and yep. Pat will be going on, unless something drastic happens, to face Debbie Conrad, fifth seed in the 13-rung ladder.
Betty will finish up with either a 122 or 123, depending on whether she gets this pin. And it's a 123 for Betty Byron.
Nice showing. Rookie of the year, Pro Tour winner at Hagerstown, and I'd say she had a pretty nice first year on the WNDA.
Coming into the tournament, she was fourth on the overall money winning list for the WNDA for this year. Adds to her total.
I told you,
29 after 9.
Just somehow finds a way to get to the 40s, Mike. Nothing spectacular this game, but caught the double and then, of course, just made this shot, struck in the ninth frame.
Oops.
141.
Just about her average. She wins it by 18. 141, 123, and she'll move on to face Debbie Conrad right after this. Back here at Fairlane's Prince George, Debbie Conrad taking on Pat Maughlin, the winner of the last match. Debbie, 225 high single, 499 high three game set. She's got three grandchildren. And happens to also be the daughter of Jimmy Wolfensberger, fine pro tour and overall duck pin bowler.
One of the best.
Member of the DPBA Hall of Fame. She's been around the bowling game a long time.
Her daddy was one of the classiest acts that ever stepped upon the approach, Mike. He was just a pleasure to watch perform, and I'll tell you, it was, he made 98 look good.
Well, here's Pat Maughlin back again. Nope, starts with a strike.
Lady wins from all angles.
She'd have four more matches to win if she was hoping to get to the top.
Boy, I tell you, there was something that being the opponent, you certainly don't want to have Pat come out of the gate with a double. Strike spare is bad enough, but a double, I mean, she'll just take it and keep on going.
So Debbie will get back up. She's already, even regardless of what happens in this match, exceeded her previous high pro tour finish, which was eighth. Where she can finish here is sixth.
Pretty ball. Oh, tough break. Tough, tough break.
Try to slide that one. Eight frames, 17 after two.
Oh. Debbie got to get it going here. Third frame. 13 pins plus behind.
Yep.
All right, no better.
That's
break.
A little bit better for her, yep.
Had the 4-5, kicked the number 5 out.
And she's got it. Well, that's what she needed to get things started. A mark comes in the third frame. And Pat Maltin steps up.
Had a little pull on that ball. I think she really thought she was going to miss it. Pat, frame 3. Tell you, Pat's style, I mean, when you tell people to follow through and snap the ball, if you watch, she sort of cuts the ball back. If you watch her hand, see where it stops? She gives it that, ooh. Thought she was outside far enough to make it, Mike. But she really just sort of cuts it right where she lets it go. It's really not a, now that, she's amazing. She delivers it so many ways. But if you watch, her strong point is that she's solid at the line. And she has a slow enough and short enough arm swing that it's under control. So she makes the adjustment right at the release point. Watch, see how short her arm swing is? I mean, the total arm swing is only about a foot and a half, maybe 2 foot at the most. How much can go wrong, you know, in that distance? Well, Swede, you know, one of the top, of course, men's pro tour performers and overall bowler, is very short. He kind of cuts the ball. He snaps it loose, and it's really, he doesn't have a long follow through.
No. It's like everything else in baseball or golf. They talk about a compact swing, right?
Exactly. And then just turning it loose at the end. And that's what Swede does so well. It's what Pat does very well. It's,
well, 2 open frames. Gives Debbie Conrad opportunity to climb back in the match, working on the mark in the third frame.
Good ball. Well,
counts 8.
You know, you talk to, I mean, a 5-year streak, I don't know if anyone's been on one any better than Swede Labors over the last 5-6 years, and he'll tell you he shoots object pins. You know, and it's, you think someone that's averaged what he's averaged over that length of time would be shooting pockets and shooting to try to slide shots. And nice shot by Debbie. He's told me personally, Joe, I just keep shooting the closest pin to me. You know, and if it works out, it works out. And if it don't, I know that, you know, that I did what I could do.
Right. If you deliver the ball where it's supposed to be, law of averages say that things are going to happen for you. You know, and I think that's what happens with the good bowlers. They, you know, the law of averages, they make enough good shots that it does, I don't want to say it catches up with them, but it pays off in the scoring, and that's.
Well, they make things happen, you know. It's good ball. She had 3 of them in the right corner, but it, number 7 just stood without even a wiggle.
Stood tall, and Debbie's come on now, yeah.
4 behind, 58-54. Both bowlers have completed 4 frames. Debbie shooting at a 1-pin spare break, the number 7. In the 5th frame.
Yes, she's got it. So, 3 in a row for Debbie Conrad in the 3rd, 4th, and 5th frames after Pat went open in the 3rd and 4th. Has changed this match around a little bit.
Seven, 8, not much you could do about it. Shoot 1-1. Of course, knowing Pat, she'll tilt it over, so I don't want to predict too many things.
She gets the 10, 68 after 5. Pat knows she was fortunate to end up with a spare break opportunity here.
Well, it was almost identical to the ball the last frame when she broke the 7-8. Just catching a head pin a little weak on the right. Again, not quite trusting it. Over-trusted that one. See, the thing, one of the things with Pat that I've, and I've known Pat many, many years and have bowled with her in doubles and so on and so forth, but one thing with, if Pat doesn't have a happy medium, is she's either very pumped up and the adrenaline's flowing, or she almost falls asleep. And if you, you have to stay on Pat. You know, you have to keep her moving, you have to keep her in the game, and she has to almost want it. You can tell before she steps up there if she's prepared. And I think what happens too, Mike, is sometimes she expands, so much energy is lost in a burst that it's, the letdown comes pretty easy. It's tough luck. The ball went right, just missed the pin. You can see it. Neither of these bowlers throw the ball extremely hard, so you can really watch what happens. She has taken a lead. If she hits this, it'll be 81 to 77 after six frames. Three or four pin lead, depending if she hits this.
Which, where she came from at the start of the match, she's pretty happy with that.
Just kept pecking away. And of course, Pat come out of gate strike spare, but she's going flat for four frames.
Debbie Conrad moves over, will bowl the seventh frame.
You just, at this point, you really don't want to do anything to let the sleeping dog lay, you know, you just. Oh my, do you know, Mike, she just got the first row, the second row, and the last row. She left the complete third row, the four, five, and six. Not something you want to keep doing.
Or but probably could keep doing if you wanted to.
No,
right?
It's her extreme angle. She bowls, her end actually comes from almost the number, what you'd call the number 40 board from the right side. And it's crossing, plus she turns it a little bit from right to left. So when it goes off, it actually is heading for the channel after it hits the number one pin on the left side.
Well, Pat is down. Point where she needs a mark here.
A little more aggressive that time. Yep. You could see she knows that she floated. I call it floating with her style. She just sort of floated the last couple balls down the lane. And that when she was got up over the line, she's amazing at what she does right at the line. She can lay it down. She can get it out. She can back it up. She can throw it straight. It's
first mark since the second frame. With a more than a four here in this fill, she'll take the lead again in the match.
She kind of attacks her game like a golfer's short game. She's got a lot of finesse, you know, a lot of touch right at the line.
Oh, we have a new leader.
And that, I tell you, that was a strong ball, Mike. That, she deserved better fate than the 9-10, but that's what she has. And a five pin lead, 95 to 90. The winner of this match will go on to face Carol Cook, third game of our match.
Well, Pat will be open in the eighth, but she has regained the lead. Picks up another 10. She's certainly taking care of her wood this game.
Lost one pin.
Yep.
Six frames. She got nine.
And here's Debbie Conrad now. For Debbie to regain the lead, she needs to have a mark here in the eighth frame.
Good ball there.
Oh, my. Back row again.
That's two frames in a row that she's had three pin splits, and I mean three pins in the same row. She left the four, five, six, and now she's left the 7, 8, and 10. You just do what she just did. You take a deep breath and hit one and one, try to forget it, and go back over to the left lane and make a mark. You get a little tired of shooting one and one in this game, Mike.
Yeah, you sure do.
When you're behind, it's not exactly how you catch up.
Wears on you quite a bit.
Well, that, you know, you're not bowling a 10-game or an 8-game. That doesn't count. The ball actually went in the channel, so it's an 8-frame. 98-105 and a 7-pin lead for Pat after two very tough breaks for Debbie Conrad.
Definitely needs a mark here in the ninth.
Well, I think you have to convince yourself that you've thrown two good balls and you don't want to make any adjustments. Don't let these breaks change your game. She's waiting for a ball to come back. You hate to throw a ball without your second ball back.
Here it comes.
Okay, Debbie. Frame number 9 on the left lane, lane number 35 here at Fairlanes, Prince George.
Big ball on the match. There, she got it. She
keep
hung with
banging
it.
Banging on it
in the same spot.
Don't give up on it, right?
Yeah, it's a big strike in the ninth frame
sure
for
it was.
It. And now must Pat will get up and finish out the match here at 9 and 10.
Gonna have to do something with one of these frames.
Oh, very fortunate there.
I tell you, Mike, she has good speed on the ball for the amount of turns that she puts. She doesn't overturn the ball and she doesn't throw the ball hard, but the speed of the ball is right for the amount of turns that she puts on it, and that's what a bowler needs, you know. Let's see if she reaches for this. Yeah, see her
right
back that
money.
Thing up. She's tough. Good control of her body and arm swing right at the point of release. And that's, I think, one of the keys to a solid game. Not out of the woods, just a big ball here. Got to have a count. She has a 7-pin lead, but as we said, Debbie was on a strike.
Ooh.
118. Debbie's 10 behind. If she gets 10 out of this, Debbie would need a mark. Very important pin shooting right here. They're important pins. Because it's all going to make, you know, mean what Debbie has to count.
Now she got the 10.
Debbie Conrad must make some kind of a mark.
Now she's got the strike and the ninth to work on. And another one of these matches that goes right down to the wire.
Yeah, she really, you know, she's either going to win or lose. She's got to have a mark. She's going to want a double would be a nice way to walk away from it. Well, she's got to make it. Got to give it a shot. So I tell you, if there's a split that she can make, this would be the one because she has
the way her ball's
exactly.
coming, right?
There's a lot of room on the side of that pin for her, and all she needs to do is touch it.
Ooh.
Almost off the other wall. We got a winner in Pat Malton. She'll be going on to face Carol Cook in the third game.
Well, Debbie picks this up. She'll lose by one. 128-127. Pat Malton wins again and advances to face off against Carol Cook in our next match. We'll have it for you right after this. Carol Cook and Pat Malton will be battling in our last match for today's show. The winner advances to next week into the final four. We're starting to get close now, Joe, to the top of that ladder and fighting it out for the $2,000. Carol Cook, 225 high single, 496 high three-game set. Highest Pro Tour finish before today, second, and she is
not exactly how you want to start a game, Mike.
She's also a proprietor in the duck pin game.
Yeah, well, the pins do not treat us any better than the bowlers. Look out. Oh, a lot of bait.
Yeah, covers for an eight there.
Got a couple stories coming up next week, Mike, and as far as how Tracy Quayle got where she's at and how Sue Hannon and Diane Jasper are also not only shooting for a star, but shooting for a bowler of the year. Pat left the 1-4, very makeable in the first frame. You got Diane Quayle, the third seed, who actually was a substitute bowler. Pat makes her spare. A substitute bowler in place of Ronnie Schwarzkopf, Veronica Schwarzkopf, who broke her ankle in three places doing the simple thing like making her approach to the line. Fortunately or unfortunately, Mike and I were standing there, and it just, for whatever reason, I was watching her, and it just folded under. It was her right foot. It was not even her sliding leg, and I said, Mike, I think she broke her ankle.
Yep, and she certainly did, and Tracy Quayle was the alternate, came right in and proceeded to rip off three straight wins to get herself into this position where she's third seeded bowler on the ladder.
Well, it was the end of 2.5 games, and Veronica Schwarzkopf was 1-1.
Right.
So Tracy went on from there to win that game and the next two. And shot, finished that game 136, shot 165 and 127, and was fortunate enough to win the 127 game. Gave her 707, and it allowed her to win Division B, which she was in, and that placed her third on the ladder. Their rules say that I'm not 100% sure what takes place. I think Ronnie Schwarzkopf becomes the alternate at that point and receives the alternate's money, whatever that happens to be, and Tracy is then bowling for herself. I do believe I'm right there. I'm not 100% sure. Between this week and next week, maybe we can find out.
And how about that? Spare strike for Carol Cook. After Pat Maltin starts the game with two straight spares, so both bowlers sending out signals that to the other bowler, it's not going to be an easy one.
Got the makings of a match. Watch out. If that's downhill, it's going to knock it down. Mike, what do you think? Here it goes.
Pat tried to give it the evil eye, but it didn't help out there.
Boy, that took longer. We could have run outside and got a crowd to come in and see this.
Ooh,
boy,
missed it.
See, there's so many times that happens. If, you know, she had to wait, and it sort of breaks your rhythm. You're waiting for the spinning pin or the rolling pin. And for some reason, you make up the time that you waited by hurrying up to shoot the shot. And the result's a miss. 47 in the third. Carol Cook will take the lead, or at least has a supreme opportunity to tie the game in the third frame. Pat bowling frame four. Now, had that happened before, it would have been a little different game when it rolled. And I really don't think that hit it any harder. It just,
no. Pat called it. She said two, and two pins went down, and she has a spare in the fourth. Carol Cook will step in, working on the strike in the third. She put back-to-back marks together. And how about another one, a double?
Carol Cook's best finish on the Pro Tour being a second. 225, a big game.
Well, she says her daughter Erin is 14 years old and a member of the youth bowlers up there in Rhode Island. Mom and dad are bowlers, and between the four of them, they get 125 years of bowling service there. It's a lot of bowling.
Yes. And you know that 14 years old, Erin does not make up most of that 125 years.
It contributes her share, but certainly not the majority of it.
I'd say mom and dad have about 40 apiece, probably.
.82 after five for Carol Cook. Whoa! Pat turn around because she was disgusted with the ball she threw and unfortunately didn't get to see the rainbow at the end of the lanes there.
You don't think she knew that was a strike? That's why she turned around?
She knew as soon as the crowd started cheering. She looked back, she wasn't even surprised, actually.
Well, I tell you, the strike helps, but it doesn't make you any more pleased with the ball you've just thrown.
Right.
But it certainly makes the match a little different. 77.
Gives you a little oxygen, though, hoping that maybe you can put something good together here.
Well, you like to take advantage of the situation at this point. Ooh. She said, I'll take that. After the shot I just threw, it's a little bit of justice.
I think 7-10 left.
Well, I think she feels like she deserved that, you know, and had the one not fallen in the fourth or fifth frame, then could have been two open frames. So, and she just took the lead. So maybe it's a little easier to justify accepting this 7-10 split when you're taking the lead, right? 86 to 82 after five frames for both bowlers. Pat shooting for 10. And that would have made it. Said you shot the wrong pin. She shot the one she knows she can hit, and that's the 7. She has her problems with the number 10, and the only reason that that would have made the 7-10 is she almost missed it.
Right.
Carol's got to get it going here. Only 4 down.
Yeah, she's got it.
Nice shot. Tough shot, Mike. I mean, she made it look relatively easy, but that is a tough shot to squeeze that back pin off and still grab the corner.
Oh, she threw the backup ball. She was on the right side of the head pin.
I tell you, she throws her ball moves very different.
Yep.
If you watch her hand, she actually hooks the ball with her hand, but it slides. Watch her release. She goes around the side of the ball. She's not under it like Pat. Broke that time she was, but she pulled it.
Yeah, she pulls to within 3, although she would have liked to have had a bigger fill there to take the lead.
Very disappointing ball to her right there. Boy, that would have been a strike had she hit. Look out, the pin can catch it.
Almost. So she puts a 10 up on the board, 103 after 7.
Pat kicked the 10 out that time. Frame 7 and 8, Pat will be bowling. Now let's see what happens here. This is her problem pin, simply because the lady refuses to move. Watch, she'll shoot this thing right down the rail. It's a tough shot. I don't care if she makes it 10 times in a row. I'd say that's not really the way to go about it.
Well, another spare for Pat Malfan in the 7th. Winner here advances to next week. Take on the top 3 seeds. Shooting at $2,000 top prize. Counts 8 on the spare.
Here's one of the things that makes Pat's game what it is. If you notice, Pat always has pins on the deck. And that's simply because the turn on the ball is right for her speed.
Another mark. So then she jumps up, puts back-to-back marks on the board in the 7th and 8th. And now Carol Cook bowling in the 8th and 9 will have to make something happen here mark-wise. Put a 10th pin on the board here in the 8th frame. Will Carol Cook? .112, Carol Cook. .124 plus for Pat Malfan in the 8th.
Cow needs a mark right here. An X would be the best kind of mark, too. Pat only has two open frames. One of those a single. Actually, both of them are singles, Mike. Pat has two open frames. They were both one pin spare breaks.
Well, Carol's got a single to hit at now.
A must single too, Mike. This just has to be. Oh, just enough.
Just enough to see it up on the scoreboard.
Well, Carol can shoot 162. Pat Malkin going along at a 144 plus clip. So if she were to count and mark one of the last two frames, she's pretty much going to close Carol out.
Big nine.
She'll miss another one here. But that's 33. And if she shoots, if she makes this and counts real big, she's going to put Carol on a double and triple.
Well, she's got it again. Three marks in a row as she's turned this one around in the seventh, eighth, and ninth. And we'll bowl on the 10th. She's got 143 plus, so she'll be well over 150.
Yeah, when Pat slipped by that first game, 128 to 127, I would say it was like putting a little fuel in her tank.
Looking for a third straight win.
First two balls Carol throws are going to have to be strikes.
All right, let's see. Pat's going to finish up here.
She hits two of them. She hit all three. Didn't leave a pin on the lane. Three open frames, 159, Mike. And Carol Cook needs strike, and eight. So if this is not a strike, Pat will be back next week to face Tracy Quayle.
That's
it. That's exactly how it's going to be.
Nice 10, 137 for Carol Cook, but Pat Malthan wins it, and she'll return next week. And we'll wrap things up here at Fairlane's Prince George right after this.
Well, we're down to our final four bowlers in this WNBA Grand Prix, and Pat Malthan will join our top three seeds next week when we return with Duckpin Magic. For Joe Reinier, I'm Mike Sella. See you again next time, everybody.
Hold on to your seats. The fun and excitement of duckpin bowling is rolling your way. It's time for Duckpin Magic.